All right, thank you so much, Tom. It's great to be here. Thank you guys so much for having me. So if we want to protect the world around us, we need to know how it works. But natural systems are complex, right? They're made up of many different species interacting with many other different species in this really complex web of interactions. So if we want to paint a comprehensive picture of how a system works, we need to study really intensively many different species over large spatial scales for long periods of time, and this is hard. I mean, traditionally we've done this by putting people on the ground, whether it's radio telemetry to track animal movements, or direct observations of animals in the field, behavioral experiments. And often, you know, I couldn't resist a sort of quintessential at the end of a field looking a little bit worse for the wear picture, sort of in the spirit of Robert's plenary talk. This kind of on-the-ground fieldwork is incredibly important for generating, as we've heard in some of the plenaries, a sense of intimate knowledge of a system and generating a desire to protect the systems around us. But if that's all you have, it can be difficult to collect data at the scope and scale necessary to answer questions in this bigger era of global change. And so, fortunately, technology is changing the way that we collect data, whether it's underwater cameras scouring the bottom of the sea to satellites. Satellites tracking weather, tracking landscape change around the globe, to remote cameras taking pictures, capturing the secret lives of some of the most elusive animals. We're collecting data at unprecedented scales, and we're integrating monitoring networks at global scales, and some of which you've heard about this week. But as these networks expand, the pace at which we're collecting data is faster than we can interpret it, and we're moving the bottleneck for understanding the world around us from collecting data to interpreting it. So take an image like this. To turn this into usable scientific information, we need to know what's inside of it. And that's not actually that easy for computers to do. So I bet your five-year-old niece or nephew could tell you that there's a zebra in this photo. Probably tell you about how many of them there are, and maybe even that there's another critter in the background. If you send this to a computer, a freely available, the freely available algorithms on the web, it tells you it's 66% sure that's a picture of a landmark. It's also 66% sure it's a picture of a nature scene, but it's also 51% sure that it is a picture of the Taj Mahal. And so, right? So, despite ongoing advances in computer vision, this is the kind of pattern recognition that people are uniquely good at. And so what I want to talk to you about today is how we can engage people through citizen science in interpreting these large-scale data sets, not only to generate new discovery, but also in the process, creating a more engaged, a more interested, and perhaps more environmentally aware general public. The same general public, I should point out, that also votes for politicians who determine science funding and conservation action. And I want to do this first with an example that hopefully will keep you awake after 5 days of conferencing. So I got my start in ecology here at the University of Minnesota, working with Craig Packer, and my research focused on basically why lions are jerks to other animals, or I guess I should say the implications of that. So I was studying how lions, hyenas, cheetahs, and the large carnivores divide up the landscape in terms of space and time. And even though we had the lions radio collared, I needed to know what all the other large carnivores were doing. And so I set up camera traps on trees where there are trees, and poles pretty much everywhere else, because a lot of the Serengeti looks like that. And I set up a lot of them. 225 cameras across 1,125 square kilometers in the Serengeti. And as anybody here who's worked off-road in systems knows, that's a lot bigger than it sounds. Now, there are logistical difficulties. This is just a smattering of the cameras that did not survive that first season in the field, to elements or more often animals. A lot of the cameras' last photos looked something like this. So notice the timestamp. Notice the timestamp. It's 10:44:49. 2.5 minutes later, that's the inside of that hyena's mouth. right? So despite some logistical difficulties, so no one said technology made things any easier. We just, you know, it just gives us more. So despite some logistical difficulties, the cameras started taking pictures. And some of these pictures are just amazing. They're beautiful, they're random, they're evocative, kind of silly. But there were a lot of them. We were getting hundreds of thousands of triggering events every single year, and this was way more than I or even a small army of undergrads could keep up with. And so I teamed up with a colleague, Margaret Kazmala, who was a grad student at the time, and we partnered with an organization that none of us had ever heard of called the Zooniverse, to go online and ask people to help. And we built a website, and we called it Snapshot Serengeti. And the website is designed so that you don't have to be an expert to make a valuable contribution. Even if you don't know what you're looking at from that really long list of species, you can filter down the options by shape, color, or by pattern, color, horn shape, body shape. That's my personal favorite. Actually, tails might be. But you can also get more information about what you're seeing to really feel comfortable with the answer you're contributing. But the point is that anybody can go online and participate in this research project. And people can go online and talk about what they're seeing. We have discussion forums where people chat with each other and with the researchers about what they're seeing, what it means, and why it's important. And we launched a blog with it that that shared our experiences in the field as well as the science that that it created. So when we launched Snapshot Serengeti in December of 2012, we asked people to come with us on this adventure. We said, at this very moment in Serengeti National Park, 225 cameras are flashing day and night, capturing the secret lives of Africa's most elusive animals. We called it the Candid Camera of Serengeti, and we said, come see what animals do when no one's looking. And they did. Within the first 3 days, we received a million classifications from volunteers around the world. This knocked out an 18-month backlog of data in days. And, you know, this might be partly because, as it turns out, people like looking at pictures of animals on the internet. surprise. But it also might be because we asked people to join us in this adventure to see parts of the world that they'd never seen or that they might never see from the comfort of their own home, to explore the world around them in a new way. Whatever the reason, it worked. Since then, we've actually gotten over 20 million classifications by 50,000 registered volunteers now, and we continue to plow through data when we put it up. But a big question is, how do we turn this enormous amount of volunteer effort into usable scientific information? Because as fantastic as it is that people are participating, at the end of the day, we're trying to use this data to produce authentic scientific research. And so at the heart, and this is a question that comes up a lot in talking about citizen science for research, how do we get good data? Well, at the crux of it is that we send every image to many different people. So we can look across their answers and come up with a sense of what we think is in that photo. And also, this drives people crazy, but we don't let them say, I don't know what's in an image. And that's actually really, really important. So I just want to walk through what this looks like. Okay, so I know it's late. I know you guys have been conferencing for 5 days, but does anybody want to hazard a guess as to what this is? I'm not moving on until somebody gives me an answer. All right, thank you. Yeah, so this is a giraffe. It's very obviously a giraffe. And on the upside, when we ask people what this is on Snapshot Serengeti, every single person says there's a giraffe, there's one of it, and it's moving. I can look at those answers without ever looking at the photo and tell you, it's a giraffe. Not all images are that easy. A lot of them look something more like this. Now, that's a buffalo. I know that's a buffalo because I lived in Serengeti for a few years, and I'm used to them standing outside the house between us and the bathroom. It was an outdoor bathroom. But it's harder. Its head is partly off the image, so you can't see the shape of its horns. You can't get the best sense of just how bulky it is, and we see that in the answers. Now, most people say this is a buffalo. But a couple of people think it's a wildebeest, which is a really reasonable guess. And one very enthusiastic person thinks it might be a rhino. But again, I can look at these answers and tell you I'm pretty confident there's a buffalo in that photo, although, again, just from looking at the answers, I can tell you the photo's a little harder. Some images look like this. There's an animal in that picture. It's right there. You can tell by its eye shine, it's moving. I have no idea what that is. On the upside, neither does anybody else. When we send this to, you know, a dozen or 20 different people, every single person says it's something different. We see bat-eared fox and civet and dictic, which is this cute little antelope thing, bovid. But everything's small. And moving. I can tell you just from looking at these answers that, one, there's an animal in that photo. It's small. It's moving. And I will probably die without knowing what it is. And that's okay. So the thing is, so now we have all of these many answers per photo, and now we have to aggregate across all those different individual answers to produce a single final answer for each image so we can actually go do science. And for Snapshot Serengeti, we do this with a very simple plurality algorithm. At the end of the day, we essentially take the species that got the most votes. Now, it's a little bit more complex when there's more species, more than one species in an image. And it gets a little messier when we try and assess counts. But at the end of the day, this works pretty well. Now, when we compare aggregate answers to experts, which we did for about 5,000 images to validate this approach, does anybody want to hazard a guess as to how accurate those aggregated or consensus answers might be? How many people think they're above 70%? Okay, how many above 80? Above 90? Above 95? Guys, you guys are really optimistic. Okay, all right. So they are 97% correct, which blew me away when I saw these results. So when we compare the aggregate answers to expert answers, 97% correct, but that 3% of error is kind of overblown because half of that 3% are images that experts said were impossible to ID. So they don't know what they are either. And experts don't always agree with each other. For images where multiple experts saw a photo, they only agreed on what it was about 98% of the time. So really, volunteers, by sending every photo to many volunteers, we're producing expert quality data. Now, I want to dive into this accuracy just a little bit more, partly because I think it's really cool, but also because I want you guys to walk out of here thinking like, hey, maybe I'll do this myself. And that 97% is not evenly distributed. Some species are simply harder than others. And so we can see this. This is a plot of the false positive, of the false negative rate. So you miss a species given that it's really there in a photo, and the false positives. And so these data points show the fraction of photos that had false negative and false positive errors when compared to expert answers. And you can see first is that there's a lot of variation in how difficult a species is. But a lot of species are easy. They have low to no rates of both types of error. And these are species that are really distinctive or visually striking, like porcupines or elephants. Some species, they get missed a lot. They're probably a little bit boring. Things like Grant's gazelles or topi get confused and classified as something else. And then there's some species that people really, really want to see, like rhinos. So where people are like, oh, I see it, even though it's not really there. But these two types of error are important because they have different implications for ecological and statistical analyses, and often analyses are able to handle one but not the other. So this is important. It's also important to try and figure out what makes a species easy or hard to ID. And when we compare the error rate, so take all those data points and plot them here, against the total number of times that animal shows up in the data set, we see that across the board, the more often an animal shows up, the easier it is to ID. So rare species are hard. They're both missed more, but they're also seen more when they're not really there. So this is important for a couple of different reasons. First, because if we're doing conservation, often we care, we're looking at the rare species, the closest, and even low rates of error can can be influential in our analyses, and so it's really important to address. But also because a lot of data collection methods, especially citizen science approaches that ask people to contribute data, have ways of catching false positive errors of negative of rare species, but not false negatives. For example, if somebody says, I saw this rhino, you know, in my backyard, you're probably going to be like, let me check that. Can you get a photo? But if they don't report something that you don't expect to see, that error goes unnoticed because you didn't expect to see it anyway. So false negatives of rare species are traditionally very hard to catch. Except, since we send every picture to many different people, we can actually use the variance in the answers to predict when images are right or wrong, which means that we have a way to tackle this type of error. So this plot reflects an ad hoc measure of disagreement that we apply to the answers. We use a Pilieu index, which is essentially like an entropy index or an evenness index. And images that have a score of 0 mean that everyone said the same thing. So images like that giraffe, right? Like every single person said it was a giraffe, would have a score of 0. Images like that little mystery critter would have a score of 1, and the buffalo would fall somewhere in the middle. And what I want you to see in this is, first, the vast majority of images are really easy. The vast majority of images have unanimous consensus on what's inside of it. And there's not actually all that many images that are that hard. And so if we move over to the box plots, this shows the distribution of that disagreement score for photos that were correctly identified, so that were considered right or wrong when compared to experts. And so you see that images that were correctly identified have much lower disagreement scores than those that weren't. And this makes sense, right? The more people agree, the more likely they are to be right in this particular case when we're talking about image IDs. But we can use this score then to target images that we think we need to take a closer look at. So in this whole parameter space, 97% of the images have been correctly ID'd. But let's say that's not good enough for what we want to do. So we can set a threshold measure. Let's say I'm only going to look at photos that have a disagreement score of 0.75 or lower, because I need better than 97%. And we can take the photos with a disagreement score is higher than 0.75, and we can either exclude them, or we can take a closer look at them and ID them ourselves, depending on what our analytical needs are. And within photos that have disagreement scores of 0.75 or lower are 98.2% correct. But let's say that's not good enough. If we set our threshold even stricter, 0.5, 99.7% of photos with disagreement scores of 0.5 or lower are correct. But we have a whole lot more photos above that line to look at. So the point of all of this is that by engaging people to classify image data, we not only are able to produce enormously accurate data sets, but we're also able to predict which images are correct and incorrect and target expert effort, which is often very limited, where we need it most. Meaning that we can generalize these approaches for all sorts of research projects that need human effort. So this is just a handful of photos taken from a single camera trap in the Snapshot Serengeti camera survey. And you can see that it paints a picture of the landscape and the animals moving through time. And when we combine this with the other 224 cameras in the system, we can paint a very clear picture of how the system is changing through time. But it's only by engaging volunteers through citizen science that we can actually answer the questions at the scale that we want to. And so Snapshot Serengeti is just the beginning. I should say that the first generation of ecological research is just starting to come out of the project, and it is so exciting. We are now able, through volunteer effort, to assess predator-predator movements at fine scales, to look at how herbivores are moving across the landscape in response to natural events like fire and seasonality. and I'm happy to talk about all of that later, but that's not the point of the talk. So, I want to actually move on from Snapshot Serengeti because it's just one of many, many projects on the Zooniverse Citizen Science platform. So, I had never heard of the Zooniverse before grad school. I'd never even thought much about citizen science. But through this process, I realized that it is an incredibly powerful way not just to generate discovery, but engage people too. And so after finishing my PhD, I joined the Zooniverse to help expand citizen science as a research tool. And Zooniverse, so despite the name, Zooniverse actually got its start as a space project, as an astrophysics project back in 2007 called Galaxy Zoo. Has anybody ever heard of Galaxy Zoo? All right, cool. So a few people. So I'm actually based in an astrophysics department, so it's really, really, because of this, we're based there for historical reasons, so it's really nice to be at ASM and talk about species instead of stars and galaxies. But anyway, so Galaxy Zoo started in 2007 with a project called Galaxy Zoo, and the origin story is very similar to what you've just heard for Snapshot Serengeti, in that astronomers had a million pictures of galaxies to look at, computers couldn't do it, and they didn't want to do it. So they asked people, they built a website and they asked people to help, and it was a wildly unexpected, unprecedented success. And so other projects started saying, hey, I want some of that. And so it expanded first with other astrophysics projects, but quickly grew to everything from penguin to plankton. And I just want to show you a couple of examples of other projects. So Penguin Watch launched shortly after Snapshot Serengeti in, fall of 2014, or I guess shortly after I joined the Zooniverse. And it takes photos from camera traps around the Southern Ocean. And I mean, it changes the way we're monitoring Antarctic bird populations because it's otherwise kind of tricky to get to. And you can see that the researchers simply ask you to click on penguins. I actually really like doing this project. I find it very meditative. I highly recommend it. But not as much as I recommend Snapshot Serengeti. But anyway, basically, like, you click on penguins and identify them as adults, chicks, or eggs. And the researchers are using this to track changes in penguin populations and the timing of breeding events. And even though this is ostensibly a harder task than what animal is this, we use the same approaches and clustering algorithms to turn these clicks into usable information. On old weather, researchers are asking volunteers to transcribe ship's logs from the Antarctic Ocean and Oceania. And there's other climatologists. They're asking folks to transcribe climate data, barometric pressure, temperature, precipitation, and basically you draw boxes around the text, and then eventually you type out what it is. And this is actually a really hard kind of task to combine answers for, but it's working well too. And the researchers have now incorporated the citizen science data into much more robust assessments of historical climate patterns. So this is changing how we understand climate change. More recently, we've extended beyond academic research projects into humanitarian relief. Now, there are other projects that try to crowdsource the targeting of aid effort, but they are notoriously, they've notoriously had difficulties in terms of accuracy of data and the ability to effectively target relief. And so we launched the Planetary Response Network fully after the Ecuadorian earthquake. In partnership with the European Space Agency and Planet Labs, we pipe satellite data into this project and ask volunteers to identify structural damage, road blockages, and road blockages, and they're able to flip back and forth between before and after photos to help target relief effort. And after the Ecuadorian earthquake, when this project launched, this platform launched, we were actually able to identify road blockages that helped to guide how relief effort navigated their way through the affected areas. So, and we expect this sort of real-time approach to change how we provide aid. So the point of all this is that Zooniverse has a lot of projects. And it's been doing it for a while now. You know, we've got everything from astronomy to archaeology, from plankton to penguins. And at the core, you know, our goal is to produce authentic research. Zooniverse has published over 100 peer-reviewed publications on these various projects. And as we grow, we expect this to pick up. But engaging people to produce discovery is just one part of what citizen science is about. It's also about engaging people in the scientific process and creating a more scientifically literate, interested, involved general public. And I want to talk about some of the lessons we've learned from Zooniverse. So we have 1.5 million volunteers around the world in almost every country. Although, as you can see from this map, they're heavily concentrated in the United States and Western Europe. But when we ask people why they classify, this is what they say. They're interested. It's distracted, it keeps my mind off of things. But these are non-exclusive answers, so people can submit more than one. The greatest response we get, though, is that I like to contribute to scientific progress. I want to make a contribution. And it's this sentiment that keeps people coming back. Now, and I find it really powerful. So one person wrote in, "I love it in general. If I wasn't disabled, I'd be a scientist. And so it feels like in a tiny, tiny way to be a part of something that matters." And this, "I posted a thank you on the forums, but would like to reinforce just how thankful I am to yourself and everyone involved. From a civilian point of view, being afforded such an amazing opportunity to contribute to an important scientific project is nothing short of incredible." And it's these kinds of sentiments that blow me away from our volunteers. Here I am as a researcher, interested, at least originally mostly, in getting data processed so I could finish my dissertation, and here are people who are helping me, that I'm incredibly grateful to, who are grateful for an opportunity to be a part of something that they think matters. And it never stops giving me goosebumps to have such an incredibly committed, engaged volunteer community. So perhaps because of this desire to contribute to science, when we ask people for help on a project, they rise to the challenge. And we see this time and time again when we send out a newsletter to our volunteers. We say, "Help us, this project needs your help." And they do. But my favorite example of this comes from a project that is otherwise really boring. So it's called Worm Watch Lab, and it's 30-second videos and asking you to classify, hit a key when these nematode worms lay eggs. And it's really not that appealing, right? And partly it's to train up computer vision algorithms, but the real crux of it is they're trying to understand how certain genes affect nematode behavior, which has implications for human behavior. But it's a really unappealing task, and the project hadn't been going so well. It had languished for maybe a year or so before we said, we partnered up with the British Science Association for British Science Week, and we said, we sent out a newsletter, and we said, "We need your help. Help us reach this target of 100,000 images." And within the first, 3 days, we smashed through that target. So somebody wrote, "The classification challenge that we ran during British Science Week last month was an overwhelming success. After smashing through the initial target of 100,000 classifications in just the first few days, our volunteers ended up doubling that in only 14 days. This corresponds to over one-third of the entire data set on the project in 2 weeks, right? And actually 2 months later, because the classification rates stayed basically double what they had been before the challenge, the request for help, the project finished their data set in just 2 months. So the point of all this is that you don't have to have cute, fuzzy animals to be a successful citizen science project, although for most of the folks in this crowd, that's not so much of an issue. But it does raise some interesting questions about what makes a project successful and how do we measure success in this kind of situation. Now, we have this joke at Zooniverse that we know we've made it because people are now studying us as an entity. We have We have economists and social scientists and environmental historians who are now studying this thing that is the Zooniverse, which is a little weird at times, but it leads to some interesting insights, and one of those is evaluating what is project success. So this plot comes from one of those groups studying us, and it looks at projects on sort of two levels. First, the public engagement, as well as the scientific contribution. And both of these axes are composite metrics. So public engagement reflects opportunities for learning and dissemination, learning and participation by volunteers, as well as dissemination by the research team. So things like tweets and blog posts and talk posts, the number of talk posts the science team does, as well as how long volunteers stay on a project, how much they have a chance to learn. And scientific contribution reflects not just how complete the classifications have been, so how much of the data set they got processed, but also scientific publications and resulting citations of those publications. And I should just point out that this came out long before Snapshot Serengeti started publishing, so now we're like way over on the right. But this actually came out, it used data up until about 2014. So the take-home message from this is that there is a direct correlation between public engagement and academic impact. The more engaged you are, the more blogs and the more talk posts and the more you engage and share your research with your volunteers, the more classifications you receive and ultimately the more science you produce. And I can't drive home how fundamental I think this engagement is, because that is what turns this into citizen science from mere crowdsourcing, by engaging people. You know, participating in these projects changes people. They learn, they engage, they inquire. Scientific literacy has long been held up as a benefit to citizen science, and it's not really surprising when people are setting up camera traps or collecting butterflies or doing bird counts. It's not surprising that they learn about the scientific process as well as the systems they are studying. But on Zooniverse, we're just asking people to click around on the internet from the comfort of their own homes. And the thing that I think is really cool about this is that they learn nonetheless. There was just another paper that came out by people who are studying the Zooniverse that show that even folks who participate only casually learn project-specific science on the projects they participate in. The language they use changes and grows more technical as they participate. And I think a lot of this learning happens so some of it happens in the classification interface itself. You can learn what a zebra, well, not what a zebra looks like, but like what a Grant's gazelle looks like, because by using those filters, for example. But the talk forums are where you learn why that matters. And so they aren't much to look at, these discussion boards, but every Zooniverse project has them. And the new ones actually look a little nicer. But they're places where people talk to each other and to us. And you know, they share suggestions. Here, David Bygott's helping a volunteer. He says, the topi is often seen standing on termite mounds in open plains. I think that's what you're seeing. So this person's learning not just a little bit more about what they're trying to classify, but also, also a little bit about its natural history. Here, Marik Sue's helping another volunteer identify a hyena when you can't see its spots based on its head shape and scruffy fur. And there's chances to learn about ongoing research in the system. Somebody saw a lion with a radio collar in one of the camera trap photos and was like, wait, is this for real? And David's like, yes, actually, this is science, and here's what we're doing. And so the point is that people are able to learn, they're able to share, and they do it. And this, actually, I just discovered this a few days ago. The Snapshot Serengeti volunteers, completely on their own, launched a fun fact of the day chat board on Snapshot Serengeti Talk, where they share fun facts of the day. And I'm learning things that I didn't know. For example, this one is about where the Grant's gazelle got its name. And it's from a Scottish explorer. And there's Lieutenant Colonel Grant. Colonel James Augustus Grant is where the Grant's gazelle got its name. So I'm learning things that I didn't know, and it is so much fun. But my favorite thing One of my favorite things about the Zooniverse is that sometimes we find things we're not even looking for. Now, at the risk of giving you whiplash as we bounce from snapshot Serengeti to outer space, quite literally, this example is just too powerful to pass up. So this is an image from Galaxy Zoo, the original Zooniverse project, and people were asked to classify those galaxies as spiral or smooth. That's all the researchers cared about, because that tells them about galaxy evolution, which tells them about the history of the universe. But one volunteer saw this blue smudge here, and she's like, wait, what is this thing? And she starts posting on the talk forums, and she's like, what is this vorver, which is Dutch for thing? And most astronomers had looked at this image and been like, oh, you know, like they don't even see it because it's probably an artifact. But enough people started talking about it that the researchers sat up and paid attention, and they realized that that thing was, in fact, something quite real. And so they tasked the Hubble Deep Field Telescope to take a closer look. And it turns out that this is a very real phenomenon that had never, it was a completely new astronomical object that had never been documented before. And it's actually really important for galaxy evolution. It's called a quasar ionization echo, and I have no idea what it is, but it's it's really important for galaxy evolution. And the point is that it took, you know, other people had seen this photo before, experts had seen this photo before, but it took a fresh set of eyes looking at the same old data to discover something new. And that's Hani, who then was catapulted into citizen science fame. But this is one of my favorite things about the type of citizen science that happens on the Zooniverse, is that we see things sometimes that we don't even know we're looking for. And sometimes those things we see have profound implications for the work that we're doing. So at Zooniverse, we want to make citizen science available to researchers everywhere. And this is largely why I joined the Zooniverse team. In 2014, we received funding from a Google Global Impact Award to build a generalized platform that would let any researcher anywhere use citizen science on their own. Because building a Zooniverse project historically has not been easy. It's taken 6 months of full-time dev effort and graphic design, and we've made a lot of mistakes, but we've also learned a lot about how to do it well. How many of you guys use camera traps? Okay, keep your hands up. Satellite photos? Aerial images? Okay, all right, so there's a good number of you. How many of you would be interested in asking, or how many of you sometimes wind up with more data than you can go through on your own? Okay, how many of you would be interested in this sort of citizen science project? Okay, all right, that's cool. Well, what if I told you, now you can do that easily. In June of 2015, so just about a year ago, we launched the do-it-yourself platform, the Zooniverse Citizen Science Project Builder, where you can go online and build your own snapshot Serengeti, your own Galaxy Zoo, your own Penguin Watch, pretty much your own anything. And we launched this, and so it's right there, zooniverse.org/lab. And we launched it with a very tongue-in-cheek demo project about classifying cats on the internet, because what would the internet be without cats? And this project walks you through how to build the demo project. But basically, it takes building a Zooniverse project from 6 months of dev effort with Ruby on Rails coding and JavaScript and CSS, and it turns it into something that looks like this. Anybody without any big data or web development expertise can go online and build their own kitty zoo, or galaxy zoo, or something more relevant. And so you can do this in the span of an afternoon. And because we've been able to generalize our understanding of how to take volunteer answers and combine them, you can also download aggregated data with the click of a button. So those final answers, no matter what it is you want to do, you get with that button highlighted in blue. So this is a whole new way of doing science that is now right at our fingertips. Since launching the Project Builder, we've launched 10, well actually, so since 2007, Zooniverse has been growing and almost exponentially. Galaxy Zoo, you can see, snapshot Serengeti there, and the end of 2012. But right there, that last one, we launched the do-it-yourself platform, and you can see the rate at which we're growing is getting faster. Since launching the platform, we've had over 10, maybe over 13 projects, research teams build their own project and launch it on the Zooniverse homepage. We have hundreds more in various stages of development. And the vast majority of these projects are being built by ecologists. This sort of pink lump at the bottom shows that the ecology projects are some of the fastest growing, discipline on the Zooniverse. So you guys have this amazing tool at your fingertips and you're using it, which is really, really exciting. And it's exciting because I really do believe that this approach to doing research will change the way we do science. So I'm acutely aware of the fact that I'm the only thing standing between you and the food and drink at the closing ceremonies. So I'm gonna wrap things up. If we wanna protect the world around us, we need to know how it works, but we also need to motivate people into wanting to protect it. And we've talked about how citizen science can do this by generating an engaged public who also understands how systems work. But for the last few days, what would a conservation talk be without a quote by Aldo Leopold? But I've been thinking a lot about how we do this as uninvasively as possible. So there's a quote from Sand County Almanac that that sticks with me, and it's that all conservation of wilderness is self-defeating. For to cherish, we must see and fondle, and when enough have seen and fondled, there is no wilderness left to cherish. And so I think one of the questions that we as scientists and as people who want to conserve the natural world have to ask is, how do we do this in a way that doesn't destroy the systems in the process? And I think that citizen science, this kind of citizen science, actually gives us a very viable solution. Because technology is changing the way we collect data, and citizen science is changing the way we turn that data into discovery. But the intersection of the two, where technology and citizen science come together, letting people engage in the world around them, often remotely, may, I would argue, let us tread more lightly on the places we're trying to preserve. So, thank you. Yeah, absolutely. That's a fantastic question. So the development of the platform that was funded at Oxford was largely to build this tool to help scientists do this on their own. But we have the same sort of pocket of funding at the Adler Planetarium that is geared to trying to figure out how we can put this in the hands of the community from the start to the finish in several different ways. And so we actually engage, so when projects start building on Zooniverse, if they want to launch on our homepage, they go through a review process. And that review process includes the volunteers. And so we say, not only is there beta feedback you can give us about the interface, but do you think this is appropriate? Do you want to see this on the Zooniverse? Why or why not? And we're still figuring out how to scale that more completely, because trying to figure out, we don't want this to be a popularity contest. We want things to have authentic research value, but at the same time be things that that non-scientists find meaningful. And so we are still very much figuring out how to do that. But the end goal is to engage volunteers from the start to the finish. I should also say that on top of that, we have several sort of educational projects that try to give volunteers or students or anyone who's interested a chance to explore the data much more deeply. And so Galaxy Zoo Navigator is still in operation, and that allowed people to classify in classrooms, and so in groups, and then look at those classifications that they made and their group made, and explore results on scatter plots and histograms. And we're building something similar for a project called Wild Cam Gorongosa that we're hoping that we will launch at the end of this summer. That it's very similar to Snapshot Serengeti in that it's pictures of African wildlife, but there's an educational component that allows teachers to select images that they want students to classify, and then the students can see their classifications on a map and download that data to explore on their own. Yeah, so on our old platform, we actually had a good system for handling translations. This sort of do-it-yourself builder, project builder, required an entirely new infrastructure, and we are still trying to figure out how to tackle translations, but we actually have a large number of our projects have non-English-speaking volunteers. And so I think one of the tricks is figuring out what text gets translated, and then giving people an easy way to do that translation, because the project content is one thing, but then there's buttons that, you know, are universal across different projects. And so we are working on it. It's something that we feel very strongly about. I think Galaxy Zoo has been translated into over 24 different languages. Snapshot Serengeti also exists in Polish. We have randomly this like incredibly dedicated base of Polish volunteers. But so people will often be like, hey, can I translate this project? And on our old platform, we could set someone up as a translator and they could go in and give us the text. And so we're still working that out on the new system. Right now, no. The project builder, so we say right now you can only upload 10,000 images until you need to talk to us. Then that's simply because the uploader has a few issues that we're still working out. But basically, so it's just not very user-friendly. We're working on it. But the short answer is no. So if you go through the process of saying, like, I want to be a Zooniverse project, we will work with you to work on, you know, for as much data as you want. And the lifetime is, I mean, as long as we can guarantee being around. You know, we are funded by grants, often from institutions. So the short answer is no. Mm-hmm.
So classifying animals is one thing. A lot of us work in museums with dead animals. Are there any projects that involve dead animals or digitizing landmarks or doing beyond just classifying, like actually digitizing specimens, for example?
Not the process of digitizing itself in terms of like taking the images and uploading them, but we do have two projects that work with museum specimens. So Notes from Nature, and I think there might be some Notes from Nature folks in the audience. So Notes from Nature is here, or is a Zooniverse project, and it's a partnership with several different museums and institutions, and asks people to transcribe museum specimens for plants and various animal collections. We're also launching one shortly with the Bell Museum that has a much sort of more local focus and is framed not just in terms of transcribing specimens, but in terms of answering a research question. So we have transcription projects for museum specimens.
Do you see a difference in interest between dead and live animals?
So the museum, our Notes from Nature has not been the most successful Zooniverse project in terms of the amount of volunteer effort contributed, and I think that's less about the content and actually more about a couple of other things. The first is that it's sort of our first sort of like federated project in that there's different institutions that fall under one umbrella, and I think we're still figuring out how to do that effectively, creating the sense of an organization while still giving each project its individual identity. Also transcription, so a lot of this is, you know, copying down text, and transcription is a hard, tedious thing to do. the transcription projects that that have been really successful have these incredibly compelling storylines. Old Weather is one of them, and that's tabular data, so that's easier. Old War Diaries is another, which asks people to transcribe the notebooks from, I think it's the First World War. So those projects get a lot of interest because I think they have this really strong storyline. And so I think what we're still just trying to figure out what it is that we need to do to get people to transcribe and get excited about that.
You can tell Ali's excited about this, and it sounds like a full-time job. I forgot to say she's also doing a postdoc at Oxford. Was there another question?
Yeah. No, I don't think so. Not that I'm aware of. But if you know anyone who's interested.
Do you have data on the demographics of the people that are involved? I mean, older, younger, limitations on who can volunteer?
There are no restrictions. We don't require that people do any sort of training. We don't take any proficiency tests. So we don't collect demographic data and we don't actually even require that people register. Like, you can make classifications without even creating a Zooniverse login. But we have done surveys of our volunteers and asked about demographic information. And what we've seen sort of generally is that we are a pretty even split male and female. Slightly more, like maybe 53% male, which is about sort of what the internet is if you look at demographic information on the internet. Age ranges, there's pretty evenly distributed from like 8 to 80, which is kind of cool. We have a slightly more educated crowd in that I think a slightly higher percentage of our volunteers have a college degree than if you took a random sample of people online.